Good afternoon. It is so good to see you here this afternoon at our next installment of the Senior Health Series on Understanding Chronic Condition. Today's session is focused more on heart health and what it looks like for prevention as well as for recovering after the event has taken place. So we have our cardiac rehab team at Sparrow joining me here today. We have Sarah Smith, who's one of the dietitians at Sparrow. She may look familiar to you because she has assisted with some of our lifetime programs. We have Bree and Alyssa, both with cardiac rehab at Sparrow. So we're very excited to have them with us for our presentation today. We want to give a special thanks to Ingham County Medical Care Facility on Dobie Road for joining us today as a table sponsor. You may have gotten a goodie bag from them as you walked through the door. And also there's some granola up at the back that was brought by Bertram Hills. So we're so grateful for their support as well. Without further ado, I'm gonna go ahead and turn it over to the ladies for the presentation today. We are gonna ask, if you can, to leave your questions for the end, and then we'll try to bring around the microphone, or we'll have the presenters repeat your question into the microphone. That way everyone can hear it. So feel free to use your binder to write down any notes or questions as they come to you, that way you don't forget them. But without further ado, please join me in welcoming our presenters today.
Hello, I noticed a couple of you from cardiac rehab, so hi again. We're gonna get this started. So this is all about keeping your heart healthy, both cardiac-wise and for diet, which we'll bring Sarah into this as well, of course. So for Sparrow, there's so many different locations where you can go. There's also obviously non-Sparrow locations available for you in this area. For both cardiac or for diet, there's a lot of things that are online, which I think you guys got some papers on that as well, virtual or just meeting one-on-one with a dietitian. So there's many different areas for you guys to locate these resources to you. So for risk factors for cardiac, the things that you cannot control are family history. So someone in your immediate family who has had a heart attack, a stent, a valve, a bypass, anything heart related, it's genetics a lot of the times, or it's, you know, in your family when you're growing up, you're eating the same things. So usually it's not really much controllable. And same with age. Usually anything above 45, 50 years old, you're at a risk for heart disease. Things that you can control are being diabetic, so watching their blood sugars, what you're eating, obesity, sedentary lifestyle, so if you have a stay-at-home work or if you're just not moving a lot in general. Stress and depression, we'll go over all these in specifics. Hypertension and high cholesterol, and then smoking. So for diabetes, there's a couple, there's type 1 and type 2. Type 1 being juvenile and type 2 being something that usually comes on later in life. So over time, your blood glucose can damage your blood vessels and nerves that control your heart. So adults with diabetes, you're twice as likely to die from heart disease or stroke as people without diabetes. So to manage, you know, checking your blood sugars before, during, and sometimes after, using insulin, some people can have the pump or, you know, one that you have to check manually. And you should get your A1C checked at least twice a year.
So the presentation today is going to kind of go back and forth between myself, Sarah, the dietitian, and then our cardiac rehab specialist. So as far as diabetes goes, many of you probably have diabetes or know someone that has diabetes. So you may have heard or are experiencing some of these diet principles that are up here on the screen today. So you want to limit the amount of carbohydrate-containing food items in your diet. That does not mean eliminate carbohydrates. Absolutely not. Your body needs carbohydrates because carbohydrates are the fuel to your body, kind of like your gasoline in your car. Your car can't go very far if you don't have gasoline. So what carbohydrates do to our body is they break down as sugar once we consume something such as a slice of bread or maybe a banana. Bananas and fruit in general has carbohydrates. It's broken down into our body as sugar. what that sugar does is it provides our body energy. However, when you're diabetic or just trying to have a healthful diet in general, is you want to focus more on those complex carbohydrates, the carbohydrates that are more nutritious for you. So focusing more on fruit, bananas, apples, oranges, grapes, strawberries, you know, all of the fruits that we have available to us. Other complex carbohydrates include whole grains. So 100% whole wheat bread, brown rice, whole grain pasta, quinoa, oatmeal. Those are a very few of the complex carbohydrates we have as far as grains. Some other carbohydrates to include in your diet would be dairy, maybe a glass of cow's milk, or an 8-ounce serving of Greek yogurt. Those have carbohydrates in them as well, but they also have protein and some other vitamins and minerals that your body needs. And then, of course, corn, peas, potatoes, squash. Those contain what's called complex carbohydrates. Complex carbohydrates have fiber, they have vitamins and minerals. So as you can see, the nutritional profile of those items are a lot more nutritious for you than having a Hershey's candy bar, even though who likes candy, right? Or more nutritious for you than maybe having, a brownie. But some of those foods can fit, just not every day. Other things that you want to limit as far as diabetes goes, and for your heart health in general, is the amount of added sugar in your diet. So I just mentioned brownies, candy, those types of things. I would say a couple times a week would be okay. That's called moderation. Other added sugar that some people consume and they don't realize they're consuming is juice, apple juice, orange juice. I have so many patients that come to me and say, I have 8 ounces or 12 ounces of cranberry juice every day. Oh my, you know how much sugar is in that? Or they're still drinking a 20-ounce bottle of Coke every day. There's a quarter cup of added sugar in a 20-ounce bottle of Coke.
We forgot the wine.
Well, that is near and dear to my heart, so I didn't want to say anything about wine. I'm just kidding. Wine, alcohol, there is added sugar in that too. So as a dietitian, I absolutely do not recommend alcohol. I leave that up to the physician. The physician knows your medications and everything that interacts with your medications. So if you came to see me as a dietitian and you asked me how much alcohol can I have every day, I would say it has added sugar. So I would limit or eliminate it, but make sure you check with your physician. And then you can learn a lot more about carbohydrates and the impact on your heart by meeting with a registered dietitian one-on-one.
All right, so one of the next risk factors that is pretty big when we talk about the risk factors that you can control are obesity / sedentary lifestyle. The two usually go together. There's a lot of ways to kind of categorize weight. A lot of people use BMI. Body fat percentage is another good one because it kind of looks at specifically how much of your weight is body fat. And then in terms of activity, a lot of people, especially in the last, almost 2 years now with COVID, haven't really been doing as much activity as they normally have. But even people who work like a desk job, you know, they're sitting most of the day. Some of the things that have been really popular are like the standing desks, and they even have like treadmill desks. So stuff like that where, you know, you're kind of just avoiding sitting. Any type of activity is better than nothing. So even if it's just getting up and doing, you know, laps around your house or your yard or anything like that, you really want to try and avoid, you know, being overly sedentary. So ideally, in a perfect world, you want to be exercising 3 to 5 times a week for about 30 to 45 minutes. So that's one of the things that we kind of focus on in cardiac rehab. Your heart is a muscle. So just like any other muscle in your body, you know, if you want to make it stronger, you're going to have to work it out. So when we talk about that, you know, mostly like
cardio exercise, so walking, swimming, biking, stuff where you're moving, you're getting your heart rate up. Those are going to be the types of things that are beneficial to your heart and can help kind of steer you away from that heart disease. So like I said, in cardiac rehab, that's kind of what we focus on. But the other important thing to remember with that too is you're probably not going to start off right off the bat exercising 3 to 5 times a week for 30 minutes or more. So you do have to kind of ease into it. It's important to listen to your body. You know, if you're going too hard or too much, then that can have the opposite effect and not be great for us.
Just going off of that too, on Amazon, you can actually buy one of those like little bikes that are just for your feet, where you can just sit on your couch, sit on your chair, and just use one of those bikes for just your feet. So if you're not one like, oh, I don't feel comfortable walking around my block by myself, there's other options that are very, very inexpensive that you can buy to use at home. So different things that you can look like that. I think there's one that you can buy for just your arms as well. So some things are like, I think they're like 25, 30 bucks. So really affordable.
And actually, going off of that, the other thing too that I like to tell my patients about a lot is there are a lot of common household items that are in like the 1 to 5 pound range while you're sitting on the couch watching TV. That soup can that's been in the cupboard for a while, you know, lift it over your head a couple times, like just stuff like that. You know, it might not be the exact hand weights, but it's the same idea. So just keeping you from really being still too much.
So leading into stress and depression, I feel like nowadays, especially with COVID, this has been a really big thing and very prevalent. So anxiety is like one thing that is really hard to control, I feel like, for a lot of people. So when you experience depression, anxiety, or stress, these are all things that are risk factors for heart disease. Your heart rate and your blood pressure naturally will rise. With that will reduce the blood flow to your heart. So you're causing literally stress on your heart every day. So if you work a very stressful job, or maybe you just have anxiety about financial, or, you know, like I used to have anxiety about just like, I'm not exercising enough, you know, like, and I think about it all day long, like, oh, I have to go to the gym after work, and it's like the last thing I want to do. Like, to prevent that, I started working out before work now. So they're just changing little things in your life to kind of prevent and reduce that. Stress, anxiety, depression will really help your heart. So ways to cope, it says on here, talking to a therapist, there's a lot of options that can be covered through your insurance or just in general. Speaking to someone, it could be a family member, a friend, a neighbor. And then there's obviously, you know, medication that you can get for this as well, and speaking to your primary care about that. Exercise is another good one, so that's why we always talk about this in cardiac rehab as well. Exercise will help reduce the stress. When you are exercising, you're releasing all these really good hormones, like almost like a happy hormone for your body. So it's very important to get out, and that's why we say just walking or just doing little things around the house, especially when you're stressed. And then finding a good support system, so going along with family, friends, neighbors, groups around yourself.
So kind of adding, so, you know, anxiety and depression, a lot of times you hear those two together. Stress is a very broad thing, you know, a lot of different people have different stressors, but almost everyone has stress. So like Alyssa was saying, you know, with the anxiety and depression, a lot of times, you know, things like anxiety and depression and stress, those aren't things that you can see in someone who's struggling with them. However, they do have very real effects on your body. So like she said, you know, being anxious or stressed or anything like that is gonna cause your heart rate and your blood pressure to go up. Your blood pressure, you know, when that goes up, that's constricting the blood flow not only to your heart, but to the rest of your body. And then stress, so actually when you're stressed, your body produces a hormone called cortisol. And what it does is it actually makes your blood stickier than it should be, which makes it more able, I guess, to stick to the inside of your arteries. So normally, you know, it flows through, but when it gets sticky like that, it can build up in addition to the plaque buildup in those arteries. So both of these things are, you know, they have direct effects on our body, and you know, sometimes they might not be the easiest things to talk about or get help for, but they are a very real risk factor for heart disease, and they can be easily managed. Like Alyssa was saying too, with the exercise, it sounds kind of silly because people don't typically like to exercise, but your body does produce a hormone called endorphins when you exercise, and that is responsible for producing feelings of happiness. So if you've ever heard about people getting like a runner's high or something like that, that's from the release of endorphins when you're exercising.
All right, so all three of us are gonna talk about just one slide here. So like Bree was saying, with an increase in the amount of cortisol in your blood, it causes inflammation. If you already have plaque buildup due to high cholesterol or cholesterol buildup, you have even more inflammation. Compound that with high blood pressure and diabetes, those four components together, your veins are very unhappy. So they're very inflamed. So what's one thing that you can do to help bring that inflammation down that you can control besides exercise? Well, some of your food choices. So if you didn't know this already, take notes. I want to see everybody's pens and pencils out. Because there are anti-inflammatory rich foods. And a lot of us might eat those on a daily basis already. You want to focus on healthy, unsaturated fats. So polyunsaturated fatty acids and monounsaturated fatty acids. Those are contained in foods like walnuts, chia seeds, flax seeds, olive oil, peanut butter, pistachios. Salmon has some omega-3 fatty acids, which also helps to break down inflammation in our veins and arteries. So thinking about these anti-inflammatory rich foods, next time that you might be in a state of stress, or the next time that you know, you're missing some exercise and you have some compound life events going on in your life that are causing stress, think about including these anti-inflammatory rich foods in your diet.
So going off of that, this kind of leads into hypertension. With the inflammatory of the stress, depression, anxiety, it leads into hypertension. So when you're stressed, when you're going through depression, you usually, it really goes hand in hand with hypertension. Your blood vessels, like she's talking about, they will get smaller and get inflamed. And so when you already have that plaque buildup, you're asking for a heart attack, needing a stent, needing a bypass, whatever it is. So hypertension, if you're not aware, we usually correlate it with high blood pressures. So high blood pressures can be, you can see the stages down there, but normally you want to be 120, 110 for that top number, and for the bottom number, 70 to 80 or below. Anything above that, you start reading into the elevated stages, the stage one and stage two, and then there's even a hypertension crisis, which is anything like 180 over 90 and above. So these are numbers that you should be checking at home. There's so many different ways that you can do this. Some doctors even give you, through your insurance, a blood pressure cuff, or you can go to like a Walgreens, CVS, wherever it may be, and get a blood pressure cuff that way. They're, again, very inexpensive. There's ones that go on your wrist, and then there's ones that go around your arm. And you wanna make sure you get the right size as well. If it's too big, it can read it too low, your blood pressure. If it's too small, it can read it too high. Either way, especially if you have family history, if you have the age, if you have some of those other risk factors we've already talked about, you have a higher chance of having higher blood pressure. So you really wanna be watching your blood pressure at least once daily. Some doctors, it depends on who you talk to, but some even say up to 3 times a day, before medication, after medication, maybe when you're stressed, when you're working out at home, checking it, or even right before bed to make sure it's not getting too low.
So yeah, this is a really big one. A lot of times you'll hear high blood pressure or hypertension referred to as the silent killer. The thing with high blood pressure is there are hardly ever any symptoms that your blood pressure is high. So, you know, we've had people come in and their blood pressure is through the roof, but you wouldn't know it if you weren't checking it. So like Alyssa was saying, when your blood pressure gets higher, your blood vessels are going to get smaller, and then your heart has to work harder to get the blood and everything to the rest of your body. On the other end of that, so I feel like a lot of times I have people ask, you know, what's too low? So when your blood pressure starts getting too low, that's something that you're probably going to feel. You might start to feel a little dizzy or lightheaded, really fatigued. But in terms of it being too low, it's kind of determined by if you're feeling those things. So we have people who, you know, they come in and their blood pressure is 98 over 60 and they feel fine, they feel great. Other people, if it's 98 over 60, they feel like they're about to pass out. So it's really important to listen to your body with those things. But, you know, I really say, you know, it's only too low if you aren't feeling well. There's not really a too low if you're feeling fine. So the other thing that is really important with this too, that I've noticed people don't have as much education about. So when you exercise, you want your blood pressure to go up. That's what we want to see. You know, your brain and your heart need more blood when you're exercising. So that's a normal response. When you're done exercising, a lot of times what you'll see is that your blood pressure comes down lower than what it was when you started. This is because when you exercise, your blood vessels do the opposite of getting smaller. They actually get bigger. They tend to stay bigger like that for about 24 hours after moderate intensity exercise. So even after you've met that demand of your heart while exercising, your blood vessels are still gonna stay open longer. So even after you're done exercising, your heart doesn't have to work as hard to get that blood to the rest of your body. So a lot of people just think that's super interesting, but you know, that's another way that consistent exercise can help you have lower blood pressure. And I'm sure Sarah's gonna talk about this, but the really important thing if you have high blood pressure is that you're watching the amount of salt and sodium in your diet. When you eat a lot of salt and sodium, that actually causes your body to hold on and kind of build up the extra water. And then your heart has to work harder to pump that throughout your body. So a lot of times people will get really swollen, like ankles or calves, if they're starting to like hold on to that water, it becomes pretty noticeable. So it's really, really important to keep track of how much salt you're eating in general, but especially if you have high blood pressure.
Just going up for that. Usually you will see a weight gain as well. You don't really want to be gaining 3 pounds in a day. That means you're holding on to fluid and water. You will usually feel bloated as well, and sometimes you can even feel it just touching your stomach. Usually you get short of breath just laying down or doing little amount of activity. So those are signs to look for as well with that. If you think that your ankles are looking bloated, we would normally check the cardiac rehab, but for you guys at home, you would just want to push with 2 fingers on the front of your leg really hard and then let it go. If you can still see your finger imprint in your leg, you're holding on to water. So you want to call your cardiologist or your primary care if you don't have a cardiologist to kind of discuss possibly doing a medication change, talking about diet, maybe seeing a dietitian. And it can relate to other risk factors with heart failure and MIs, heart attacks, and so on. It's a huge factor. And then of course, you just wanna make sure you exercise, watch the stress, and then like she talked about the salt, all right?
So far, what I'm taking away from our presentation is exercise is important. Right? No matter what, moving your body, or you could call it joyful movement, okay? Because if Bree, Alyssa, and I are going to tell you to exercise, every single person in this room is going to say, whatever. But if you find activities you enjoy that will get your body moving for that 30 minutes a day like they're recommending, wow, you just played tennis for 30 minutes with your friend. You just walked around the neighborhood with your husband or significant other for 30 minutes. You enjoy those things, right? So it doesn't really feel like exercise. However, you just benefited from all of these positive things by moving your body in ways you enjoy. So if exercise sounds horrible to you, then find some way to move your body in ways you enjoy, right? Okay, so if you are trying to manage your blood pressure or hypertension, those terms go interchangeably, then you've probably been told before you need to follow a low sodium diet. How many of you have been told that by their physician, by your physician? A few of you? Have you been given any direction on how to do that?
Yeah, don't eat those potato chips.
Okay, great advice. Don't eat potato chips. Anyone else get any good advice? No? Okay. Well, there's a lot more to a low sodium diet than this one slide that I have up here for you. So that's why there's handouts in the back. Starting October 5th, I teach a 4-week series on cardiac cooking class. So it's gonna be basically based on low sodium cooking, ways to flavor your food without added salt, the importance of eating fruits and vegetables and including whole grains in your diet, and talking about all of those anti-inflammatory rich foods. So it's free, to the community. So if you haven't taken that class before or that series of classes, or if you have and you just want a refresher course, don't miss the handout in the back that I've brought for you. So with that being said, if you're following a low sodium diet, that means that you are requested, required, educated on consuming no more than 2,000 milligrams per day of sodium. If you want to know what it is in grams, then it would be 2 grams of sodium per day, okay? I have a food label up here for you in the slide. I'm not sure if you can all see it, but I want to just kind of go over how to read a food label with you real quick, just so you understand what I'm talking about when I say 2,000 milligrams of sodium. Let's start way up at the top. It says there's 13 servings per container, and each serving size is 1 1/4 cup. So when we look at these calories, fat grams, sodium milligrams, all of these things, this right here is the cereal per 1/4 cup. This does not mean it's for the whole box, okay? So a serving size is 1 1/4 cup. So per 1 1/4 cup of this particular cereal, there's 150 calories. Okay, that's good to know. Total fat, 0.5 gram. Okay, that fits in a heart-healthy diet. There's no saturated fat, so that's even better. We get down here to cholesterol, 0 milligrams, another bonus, right? Now we're at sodium, 270 milligrams per 1 1/4 cup. So this is where it gets important that you actually measure your food. So if you think, oh, this has to be 1 1/4 cups, and you pour it in your cereal bowl, I bet you $5 it's not. More than not, it's going to be more than the recommended serving size. So if you're eating more than 1 1/4 cup, you're going to get more than 270 milligrams of sodium. If you're trying to stay under 2,000 milligrams a day, then that can add up quick if you're not paying attention to your serving sizes of different food items. So, another thing that you want to write down, when it comes to sodium, anything less than 140 milligrams per serving is considered low sodium. Anything less than 300 milligrams per serving is still acceptable. That's, you know, moderately low, per se. So this cereal would be a good choice, right? Because there's some fiber in it, but there's 7 grams of protein. So, I mean, this profile of this cereal would be an acceptable cereal to include in a heart-healthy, low-sodium diet. Do you guys agree? If you're following a serving size recommendation. I like to kind of compare serving sizes with condiments like ketchup, ranch dressing, barbecue sauce. So a serving size of ranch dressing, if you're just doing the regular Hidden Valley buttermilk ranch, is 2 tablespoons. So per 2 tablespoons, there's almost 300 milligrams of sodium. Who in this room only uses 2 tablespoons of ranch? I mean, that's a very small amount of ranch dressing if you're utilizing it for a salad or if you're dipping carrots in it or something like that. Chances are, with things like barbecue sauce, ketchup, ranch dressing, mayonnaise, all of those things, we don't measure the portion size very well. So that's where a lot of patients and consumers and people get in trouble, with their sodium intake is through all of those extra condiments that we add to our food. So really pay attention to that serving size. And then the last thing I want to touch on is just limiting processed foods and restaurant meals. So how many in here like to go out to eat, whether it's by yourself, with a friend, with a family member? We all do, I think. It's a big social thing for us, especially now that things are more open than they were a year ago, right? Restaurants get us by adding salt and fat to their food so that they taste better, so we keep coming back. One thing restaurants do not do, though, is watch the serving size of food items. So you might order a plate of, I don't know, barbecue grilled chicken and some sweet potato on the side and a tossed salad. Well, your chicken breast might be like 3 or 4 servings in one chicken breast, and then that salad is huge, which we need salad, but if you're adding ranch dressing to that whole salad, if you're having barbecue sauce on all of that chicken, they're injecting the chicken probably with some sort of flavoring or seasoning that's including salt there, you could potentially get almost 2,000 milligrams of sodium in just that one restaurant meal. It's really eye-opening when you start to read labels and when you start to really realize how many people are consumers consume a lot of sodium because of the marketing and trying to get you to keep coming back. So if you eat out, share with a friend, share a meal, or really ask the server to modify your meal. So if it says barbecue chicken breast, ask for a plain chicken breast with barbecue sauce on the side. If it says, I don't know, shrimp swimming in butter sauce, well, ask for plain shrimp with the garlic butter sauce on the side, so that you can control how much of that condiment, per se, that you're using. Because we don't want swelling to occur in our legs. So,
okay. Real quick, before we talk about high cholesterol, I just wanted to go off of what Sarah said. I know. But one of the big things that I hear patients say a lot is that they don't use table salt anymore. They don't use it on their food. They don't, you know, they don't keep it around, which is great. However, that sodium in packaged processed foods can completely outweigh table salt, you know.
So table salt use is only 20% of someone's daily intake of sodium.
Yeah.
80% of our daily intake of sodium comes from processed foods. It comes from over, you know, portioning other food items. So only 20% is that table salt that you've eliminated from your diet.
So it's a step in the right direction, but a lot of times patients are like, you know, I have no idea why this isn't helping because they're still eating a lot of processed foods. We were talking to a patient the other day about ways to cut down on sodium, and we looked up the amount of sodium in soy sauce because he was trying to figure out a good substitute. And I think the serving size was 1 tablespoon, and there was 900 milligrams of sodium per tablespoon. Which, like she was saying, if you're eating soy sauce, you're probably not going to use 1 tablespoon. So there's your 2,000 milligrams in just the sauce that you're putting on your food. So it really is important to look at the nutrition labels. So, okay, The next one that we wanted to talk about is high cholesterol. This is another risk factor that is very modifiable based on what you eat. So your cholesterol is, when we talk about the plaque that builds up in your arteries, that's cholesterol. So it's something that you want to keep an eye on. However, cholesterol can be something that's affected by genetics as well. So, you know, sometimes you can eat very clean and healthy and your genetics determine that you still don't have good cholesterol. But the things that you eat almost directly affect your cholesterol numbers. So the chart on the side there kind of talks about the ranges for cholesterol. So when we talk about cholesterol, there's actually a few different like specific pieces of cholesterol, I guess, that we talk about. So for total cholesterol, in that good range there, you want to keep that under 200. You start getting over 200, you start getting into that borderline and high. The LDL is what we, when people talk about bad cholesterol, that's what they're referring to, is that LDL cholesterol. So that you actually want to keep under 100, ideally. And then the one oddball there is the HDL cholesterol, and that is actually good cholesterol. So you really want to keep that as high as you can. That also tends to be one of the hardest ones to manipulate, but exercise is a great way to try and increase your HDL cholesterol. And then the last one that's on there is triglycerides, which this one I always kind of tie back to the diabetes risk factor, because triglycerides are mainly affected by how much processed sugar you're consuming. And I notice a lot of times when people have really high triglyceride levels, they might overconsume the wine or the beer because that has a lot of processed sugars in it. Even if they're eating a very healthy diet, alcohol has a lot of processed sugar and that can really show in your triglycerides. So
when we talk about cholesterol as well, and she was talking about the buildup in your arteries, over time, it will restrict the blood flow to your heart. So you gotta think about when you have a hose back in your garden hose, you know, you're gardening, you know what it looks like, right? So when you have all of a sudden a blockage or something in that hose, the water is being restricted and you're not seeing as much water come out of your hose anymore, right? So we gotta think about that in terms of your arteries in your heart. To open that up, like she was saying earlier, exercise is a good example. And to prevent the plaque buildup in your heart, obviously watching your diet, which we talked about throughout this presentation. And you gotta think, when that plaque buildup builds up over time, you're closing off that artery, so less and less water or blood is coming through that hose, and eventually will be blocked off completely. When it's blocked off, that's when a heart attack happens. So when you have a heart attack, you're losing the tissue, you're losing the blood flow to that side of the heart, depending on which artery it's in. And that's when you feel those symptoms, which we will cover later on in this presentation as well. Okay.
Yeah. And kind of going off of what Alyssa was talking about with the garden hose and everything, I don't know why when I was younger and like people talked about heart attacks, I thought they just like came out of nowhere. But that's not the case. So with cholesterol, I think it's a really important one because this is something that you can, you know, it starts very early on and it slowly builds up over the years. So any type of changes that you're making to try and lower your cholesterol is gonna do good. It's never too late to try and alter your cholesterol. A lot of times, you know, people think, oh, well, I've been eating healthy, you know, like a year ago, I started making all these changes. So on the flip side of that, you know, sometimes the damage has already been done. So I just think it's really important to show that it is something that happens over a long period of time, typically. It's not something that, like when I think of a garden hose, I think of like kinking it, but really it's like a gradual buildup of those little things that slowly, slowly get more of that blockage. So it might not always be like a technical heart attack. You might have some similar symptoms, but really that's your body telling you that there's about to be a problem. It's not a complete blockage yet, but it's maybe 80% blocked, and you're starting to get some of those same symptoms before it gets to that 100% blockage, no blood flow.
All right, so you guys get to hear me talk some more about food. Cholesterol and diet. Well, one way to help your cholesterol levels be lower or be more within normal range would be to limit the amount of saturated fat in your diet. Can anyone name off a food that they might enjoy that has saturated fat in it? Can't hear you.
I heard butter.
Yeah.
Butter? Yes. Butter, definitely. That is like 90-some% of just a saturated fat chain of acids. So anyone else have another favorite food that has saturated fat in it? Bacon.
Ice cream.
Ice cream. So all the things that we like, right? All right, so if you think about saturated fat and what Alyssa and Bree just said, the plaque buildup in your arteries. Think of that bacon grease that's in that fry pan after you've let it sit there for an hour after you made breakfast. It's now like a white solid, right? Lard. Think about the butter stick that's on your counter in the butter dish. It's solid at room temperature. So when you think of saturated fats, think solid, okay? So what happens when you eat these saturated fats, bacon, full fat dairy, so if you're drinking whole milk, or eating full fat ice cream or full fat yogurt, if you're consuming butter, maybe you eat fried foods. So it's the summer in Michigan, so there's a lot of fairs and festivals. So you have fried elephant ears, deep fried Oreos, I don't know.
Fried butter.
Fried butter, yes. Corn dogs, elephant ears, those types of things. So all of those food items are cooked in some sort of saturated fat. So now you've consumed butter. You've consumed bacon. So think of what's happening in your veins. It's solid at room temperature, so that fat is actually solidifying in your veins. It's causing that plaque buildup. It's gonna be solid in your veins. The fat doesn't care that your body temperature is 98.6 degrees. It's still gonna be solid in that vein of yours, and it's gonna cause plaque buildup, which will decrease that blood flow. So when you're trying to figure out, okay, well, what else should I monitor as far as fat? You want to try to eliminate trans fats as well. So usually if there's saturated fat in a product, if it's a processed item, like an Oreo cookie or something, chances are there's going to be trans fats. Has anyone seen the term partially hydrogenated oil? That is a fancy word for trans fat. Okay, so if you see that ingredient in a processed food item on the ingredient list, then you know that there is some sort of trans fat and saturated fat in that item. I'm encouraging you, I'm not telling you what to do, I'm just encouraging you to utilize those unsaturated fatty acids that we have available to us that I mentioned earlier. When you include more unsaturated fats in your diet, that's going to bring down that inflammation that cholesterol has caused, and it'll actually increase your good cholesterol, and it will help to decrease your total cholesterol. Sounds kind of weird, right? Eating fat is going to help increase my good cholesterol and decrease my bad. If you eat the right kind of fat, such as avocados, walnuts, chia seeds, flax seeds, almonds, pistachios, almond butter, peanut butter, salmon, all of those healthy fats are definitely going to bring down that bad cholesterol and increase that good cholesterol because of that inflammation. The second key component to helping to control your cholesterol levels is by far my favorite F word. Fiber, right? Who likes fiber? Everybody. Everybody should raise their hand, right? So you find fiber in foods like fruits and vegetables. You also find fiber in items such as brown rice, whole wheat pasta, whole grain bread, quinoa, barley, oatmeal, whole grain cereal, different granola bars, granola. So you want to include a mixture of whole grains and fruits and vegetables because there's two different types of fiber available to us. I won't go into the difference between the two. I'll just let you know there's two different kinds of fiber, and if you eat a diet rich in fruits and vegetables and whole grains, you're going to get an adequate amount of both types of fiber. The targeted amount of fiber per day, it doesn't discriminate between genders, so it doesn't matter. Male and female, you should have between 25 to 35 grams of fiber per day. Now, if you're someone that maybe eats 10 grams or 15 grams of fiber right now, but you really want to try to increase your fiber, I recommend going slow with that. Because if you go from 10 grams of fiber a day to 25 or 30 grams of fiber the next day, you could definitely have some stomach upset, abdominal pain, bloating, diarrhea, some other GI symptoms that isn't going to be pleasant. So make sure you gradually increase your fiber. I get asked all the time, why is fiber important though? What does it do? So fiber helps keep you fuller longer. So if you're eating a diet rich in fiber and you're being fuller longer or being more satisfied after meals, chances are your blood pressure and blood sugar both are going to be regulated better. So with your blood sugar being regulated better, you're not gonna have those highs and lows. And a lot of times when we have highs and lows in our blood sugar, even if you're not diabetic, you're going to feel hungry. You're going to want something. And when we immediately feel hungry, what do we usually want to reach for?
Cookies.
Cookies, right? So then that'll shoot our blood sugar up some more. So if you're eating a diet rich in fiber, since it takes so long to digest, you're going to stay more satisfied and fuller longer between meals, and that'll help to ward off some of those cravings that we have during the day. The second thing fiber does that's very important to our body is it actually acts as the body's broom. Okay, so if you think about you're sweeping your kitchen floor after you make dinner, getting all the crumbs and particles off the floor that you just dropped. So now you're gonna throw it away. Well, that's what fiber does. It actually sweeps out and attaches to some of those cholesterol molecules in our arteries and veins, and it sweeps it out of our system. So making sure that you have fiber for those two main reasons is very beneficial. With fiber comes the need for water. If you're exercising, you need more water. You need hydration. If you're eating a diet high in fiber, 25 to 35 grams a day, you need hydration. Water is going to help to push your food or digested food out of your system. It's going to help keep your bowel movements soft so that you don't have issues there, because who would want issues there when you're trying to do all these other things, right? So making sure that you're drinking at least eight ounce glasses of water a day or some sort of sugar-free, calorie-free beverage would be beneficial. I know some of you might be on fluid restrictions, or maybe you're not, but trying just for that, you know, blanket statement of 64 ounces of sugar-free, low-calorie beverages a day is going to be beneficial for you.
So before you go away, does coffee count?
Oh, good question.
We get that a lot.
Yes. So if you are utilizing your fluid intake for the day with caffeinated beverages, unsweetened iced tea, there's caffeine in it. Coffee, even if you're not adding coffee creamer to it, there's caffeine in it. When you are utilizing caffeine as your body's source of hydration, you're doing no one a favor. What you're doing is you're actually dehydrating yourself. Caffeine acts as what we call a diuretic, So some of you might call one of your pills a water pill. Well, that's an actual, that's a diuretic. That's trying to get excess fluid out of your system. So coffee, if it has caffeine in it, or any other beverage that contains caffeine, is actually flushing that hydration you actually need to stay in your body, it's flushing it out because caffeine is considered a diuretic. So if you do drink coffee, I would not count that as hydration. You still want to do those eight ounce glasses of some sugar-free, low-calorie beverage a day.
Smoking. So this is one that doesn't really apply to a lot of people, but it does at the same time. It can contribute to heart disease, and I feel like that should be common sense because of the chemicals that are in the cigarette. These chemicals will cause damage to your blood vessels, your arteries, and even to the blood itself. So when you damage those arteries and you're damaging those vessels, you're restricting the blood flow again to your body, which we've already talked about multiple times. So with smoking, a lot of people, I feel like they start smoking, especially when, honestly, your guys' age, when you were younger. It was a huge thing. It was really cool to do. But hopefully a lot of you have stopped. Sometimes you can stop as easy as just cold turkey, I'm done, not doing it. And usually it's because of a life event, like having a heart attack or needing a stent or something. But other ways to stop smoking would be for nicotine replacement products. So they have patches, they have medication, they have different resources that you can talk to your cardiologist, your primary care physician, of ways to help smoking, to stop smoking, other than just cutting cold turkey. So you want to identify your triggers as well. So that just means, like, why, like, when you think, oh, I want to start smoking, why is that? Is it because you're stressed? Is it because it's a cool thing to do? You're socially doing it with your friends or family? Are you just doing it because you're just doing it? You're just used to smoking? Identify that and realize, like, you need to find a different source of happiness or a different source of just trying to avoid it in general. So whatever that may be for you, and if still all of those top three things that I mentioned don't work, you can obviously find a counselor. Again, talk to your primary care about that, and just discussing ways to kind of help you stop smoking, or even just simple steps of reducing smoking. Because for some people, it's easy to cut cold turkey, and some people, it's just quite impossible. So let's say you smoke a pack of cigarettes a day. Think of ways that you can reduce this. Let's try and reduce it to only 3/4. And then after you reach that goal, let's try and reach it down to half, and then down to a fourth, and then hopefully you can down to maybe only a couple cigarettes. And that should help you eventually, hopefully, just completely stop altogether.
Do you want to mention this?
Sure.
Okay.
So like Alyssa kind of mentioned there, there's a ton of chemicals in cigarettes, and they kind of have the same effect when it comes to those blood vessels. So immediately after smoking a cigarette, not only the blood vessels in your heart, but the blood vessels in your entire body, they're going to get smaller. So I don't know if you guys have noticed the theme throughout this, but getting smaller, not good. Opening those up, that's good. So a lot of times people, you know, when they're trying to quit, people talk about like that nicotine buzz that they get. And that's actually just the cigarette constricting the blood vessels in your brain and making you feel that kind of, you know, euphoria from lack of oxygen. So it's directly affecting all of the blood vessels in your body, not just your heart, but also your heart.
And before we move on, this is including cigarettes, cigars, and chew. Those are the ones that we're specifically talking about. Marijuana, CBD, all those other things. That's up to your discretion and your doctor, okay? So leading into cardiac rehab, that's what we do, Bree and I. There's a whole slew of things that would qualify you for cardiac rehab.
So, heart attack, stent, bypass, so being a coronary artery bypass graft, we call it bypass for short, or CABG. Any angina, and that usually has to be proven after you talk to your primary care cardiologist. You're saying, hey, I'm having chest pain. And it usually you have to get a stress test done. You have to have the proof of the angina or the chest pain. And then that would usually qualify you to get you started for cardiac rehab as well. Heart valve repair or replacement. So you might have heard of a TAVR. You might have heard of an aortic valve or a mitral valve. There's tricuspid valve. There's mitral clip. Lots of big words. But the valves in your heart. And then there's stenting, which I talked about. There's also angioplasty, which is where they would just go straight in, clean out the plaque buildup in your arteries. That would qualify you, even if they don't put a stent in. A stent is going to keep that artery open. And then if you, heart failure, so heart failure is anything under 35% of your ejection fraction. So usually the way your ejection fraction is how much blood is coming out of your heart every time it's pumping. So you don't want 100%, you don't want all the blood coming out of your heart, but you don't want more, you really want around like 45, 50. But when you start reaching that 35, 20, 10, that means the rest of your body is not getting that blood flow that it needs. So that's heart failure, and that's where that sodium came in, watching the weight in your retention in your legs. So cardiac rehab, a lot of people have never heard of it. So after you qualify for cardiac rehab, which any of those interventions, if you've had it within the past, usually 6 months to a year, you qualify. Cardiac rehab, you'll come in and you'll exercise with us. There's, like I said, many different areas you can go, but Sparrow's where we're at. You'll be hooked up to an EKG monitor. So some of you might not even know what that is. It's literally like a little phone almost, and then it has wires attached to it that Bluetooth to a computer, where we're going to be seeing your EKG, which is your heart rhythm, and we will see if you're gonna, if you're having a blockage buildup, which means basically you're gonna have a whole lot of big words, but ST depression, ST elevation, we would see that, or arrhythmias, being you're having a quickened heart rate. So some of you might have heard of AFib. It could be something like VTAC, so ventricular tachycardia. There's even more, there's super, yep, supraventricular tachycardia, which is SVT. Again, a lot of big words for arrhythmias. An accelerated heart rate, or there could be even a slower heart rate, like a bradycardia. All these mean is just abnormal. And some people, like we talked about earlier, you might not even feel that you're having these arrhythmias. We would see it on the EKG, and usually it happens with exercise. So when you're coming into cardiac rehab and you're hooked up to that monitor, we're watching the blood pressure before, during, and after, making sure it's not getting too high or too low. We're watching for those arrhythmias. We're making sure that you're in the correct heart rate target zone for your age. If you want to figure this out, it's 220 minus your age. Then you take that number and you will times it by 55% and then 85%. And you want to be between that 55% and 85% of your maximum heart rate is the safe zone for where you want to be with exercise. Some people, you will not even reach that 55% because of medications you're on. So again, if you're doing cardiac rehab with us, that's something that we will monitor and letting you know that, hey, if you feel like you're in a moderate intensity zone of exercise, you're getting benefit. You don't necessarily have to be up to that heart rate to get benefit.
So the other really important thing with this and that list of, you know, events that can qualify you for cardiac rehab, anytime you have one of those events, whether you need a stent or you need a bypass or you have a heart attack, anything in that area is putting stress on your heart. They can go in and they can put a stent in and they can fix that problem, but your heart was still under a lot of stress for that time. So sometimes, you know, we talk about cardiac rehab and people say, yeah, I know, I just need to start exercising and eating right. Well, yes, but since your heart was already under that stress for that time, it can start doing some crazy things. So that is one of the things that I really like about it, is that you're hooked up to that heart monitor, so it kind of gives you that peace of mind that, you know, you are exercising safely. Whenever we talk about things like heart attacks and needing stents or bypass or anything like that, that's gonna be, you know, from everything that we just talked about, the diet and the high cholesterol and the high blood pressure. There's another side of things when it comes to your heart, which is the electrical side of things. So that's not necessarily something that, you know, eating right can affect, but putting the stress on your heart of needing one of those things can affect that. So sometimes, you know, people have one of these events and then they come to us and now all of a sudden, you know, their heart is beating irregularly because of the stress from that situation. The other thing that tends to happen is, you know, after you have a stent or a bypass, you're probably gonna be on at least a couple, if not a lot, of new medications. One of the most common medications that they will put you on is in a group called a beta blocker. Basically, its job is to keep your heart rate and blood pressure low so that you're not overworking it. However, say before this all happened, you had a pretty low heart rate in general. Now we've got a problem because on top of that, they put you on this medication, you know? So those are things that we can pick up when you're hooked up to this monitor and we can see exactly what's happening. Like Alyssa said, if it's a matter of your heart beating too fast or too slow, a lot of times those aren't things that you necessarily feel, or you may be feeling symptoms and attributing to something totally different. So being on the EKG monitor, especially while you're exercising and while you're increasing the demand on your heart, can sometimes reveal those underlying issues that could have gone unnoticed.
And if you don't qualify for cardiac rehab, maybe you've never had an intervention, maybe you're just trying to be on top of things, there's such thing as Apple watches or even just different watches in general that can monitor your heart rate. And it will actually alert you if you are in an irregular heart rate or an accelerated heart rate that's abnormal to you. So that's just a quick, easy option of what you can do at home as well. So here is our phone number up there, and I believe it's in all your packets as well. We will check with your insurance, but obviously it's very important to talk to your cardiologist about this first to get a referral. And then the other thing is our PAD program, which is currently closed with COVID, but it should be coming back hopefully soon. PAD is claudication or pain in your legs with walking long distances, uphill, whatever it may be. That's again something that you want to talk to a cardiologist about to get that looked at, and they do all kinds of different tests to see if you do have PAD or the claudication pain in your legs. But we do have a program for that as well.
Alyssa, can I say one thing? I just wanted to clarify too on that last slide. It says check with your insurance today. Cardiac rehab is an insurance-based program. So when we have that list on the side of things that qualify you for cardiac rehab, those are qualifications for your insurance. So for your insurance to pay for that program, you'd have to meet one of those guidelines. So that's why, you know, we kind of think of it sometimes as like physical therapy, but for your heart. So, and when we talk about qualifying, that's for your insurance to cover the cost of the program.
There should also be TCI's numbers in there, and that's for if you don't have a cardiologist, or maybe you're having some symptoms that we've talked about, or maybe you just want to get checked up in general. You will contact this number up there, this 9650, and they will get you a new cardiologist or a cardiologist in general. And if you have any risk factors, you know, if you have any of those arrhythmias that we talked about, AFib, which we brought up, the valves, and then the walking issues, all of that TCI will help you with, and they can diagnose it and get you going along with the right steps for that to get, possibly do cardiac rehab.
And if you want to know more about food and nutrition and how it directly relates to your heart, I am part of the cardiac rehab team, but only, you know, a couple times a month, because I don't see cardiac rehab patients every single day. So patients that go to cardiac rehab will either have a referral, and then you can call this number, the 364-2387, and that'll get you to my administrative assistant, who will then schedule your appointment. But you'll have to check with your insurance, because a lot of times insurance plans are different if they cover dietitian appointments or not. However, on the back table, I do teach cardiac nutrition class once a month. It's usually on the first Friday of the month. Everybody, consensus was to keep it virtual. So it's a Zoom meeting, basically, and it's free. It's part of the cardiac rehab program. However, I brought a flyer in case anyone's interested, just to kind of check it out. My next class is Friday, September 3rd at 1 o'clock. So for those of you that are here, don't spread the word, but for those of you that are here, if you want to learn more about heart health and nutrition, you're more than welcome to virtually attend my September 3rd nutrition class. So that flyer's on the back table, along with my cooking class. I say mine. It's not mine. It's Sparrow's, but I'm the lead dietitian in all of these things. So the cooking class that starts October 5th, that flyer's back there. And then my third flyer handout I brought is a front and back handout with about 10 to 12 different recipes for salt-free seasonings. So things you can make at home that don't contain salt if you're trying to limit salt in your diet. But I think that is all. Katie, I think, wants the microphone now.